under less than plastic time, it is non-invasive. If I have auto implant like this on the surface of the ovary, you would call it auto implant. It doesn't matter, just call it non-invasive as well. How about invasive implant? This is where it gets really, really important that this destroy, it invade the underneath. It is really irregular. Even cytology slightly get worse, slightly. Okay? See, like the way it is invading the omentum, it's not sitting with it. Again, invasive, it is infiltrating through the omentum. Same for this one. And if sometimes I have a detached fragment in the omentum and I cannot say if this is invasive or not, we call it non-invasive. Okay, and this is desmoplastic. And if it is look like malignancy, and look at this with the background, the whole thing, so we call it invasive implants. Now why it is so important? Because now the new, the final, whenever you have invasive implants, you call it low-grade serous carcinoma invasive. Okay? This is why, and this basically gets chemotherapy. So this is why it is so important to differentiate between non-invasive versus invasive. So the non-invasive most of the time denied, it is KRAS BRAF mutations, and this implant might be associated with fibrosis. This is what we call a desmoplasty. Some and rarely the non-invasive might progress to carcinoma. So this is what the debate. Currently, we call non-invasive implant epithelial and desmoplastic. We call it implant the same epithelial and desmoplastic. How about the invasive implant? Well, we call it with the new recommendation low-grade serous carcinoma. Okay? And non-invasive implant with features of low-grade serous carcinoma. Well, it is low-grade serous carcinoma. Okay. How about lymph node involvement? There are two types of lymph node involvement. I can take questions anytime. I don't want you to start. I know it's a little bit complicated, but I want you to stay with me. So if you have any questions, please start. Okay? Please.
Okay, what about if we have implants, serous, low-grade serous implants with no primer in the ovary? The ovarian tumor could not be detected.
That's a wonderful question. It can happen, luckily, rarely, luckily. And remember the origin of serous carcinoma or ovarian carcinoma in general from the fimbria, from the secretory cells of the fimbria. And then it gets by KRAS BRAF mutation to produce the low-grade serous carcinoma. And these cells, during ovulation, okay, if this is the fimbria, the fallopian tube, and this is the ovary. The fimbria will hug the ovary, and during the ovulation there'll be a wound, and these cells will entrap in the ovary, and through this mutation will produce either low-grade or high-grade. Well, the same cells might go to the omentum, and you might have endosalpingiosis and produce a borderline tumor there or low-grade serous carcinoma there. So you could have this and you call it low-grade serous carcinoma. It's the same tumor. If it is in the omentum, if it is in the ovary, we used to call it primary peritoneal tumor. Remember, that was the classification. And some people till now, they call it primary peritoneal carcinoma or borderline tumor or low-grade serous tumor primary peritoneal. It doesn't matter. It's the same cells, it's the same treatment. Okay. Wonderful question. Any other question? Good, I still know. The lymph node involvement, there are two types. Either very small, single cells and eosinophilic in the sinus, or a little bit slightly more nests, replacing the low-grade serous, replacing the entire lymph node with these tumors. And lymph node involvement occurs in 20 to 30%, and it upstages the disease, for sure. And by itself, especially the small cells, it will not alter the prognosis. We deal with it the same as the implant. If it is non-invasive, you know, and there are small single cells, it will not alter the prognosis. And I used to call it not metastasis, we call it involvement. Sometimes you see esophageosis in this lymph node, and I'll show you. So we are in the lymph node, and there are small clusters of serous borderline tumor end. And these in the sinus, few cells here and there, this will not alter the prognosis. And more high power. Again, eosinophilic cells. But here, yeah, it's completely different. It's replacing the lymph node. So this will affect the prognosis. And in the literature, this nodule should not be more than 1 millimeter. If it is more, then it will have more aggressive course. And will deal with it the same as invasive implant. Endosophagiosis, it's not that rare. Okay? We looked at a microinvasive. Herman in 2000 looked at his cohort, like 101 cases from multiple meta-analysis, not his cases, throughout multiple cases. And he looked at the microinvasive in these cases, and microinvasive was with unknown prognostic factors. This patient did wonderful. That was in 2000. Then Dr. Long-Anker reviewed more cases with more follow-up and more strict criteria for calling it. And they come up with dividing microinvasive into two types. The first one is the conventional small type eosinophilic cell pattern with a cleft around the cells that has no prognostic factors. The other one, the small invasive carcinoma, like small micropapillary pattern, but it has to be less than 3 millimeters. So these are the small clusters of cells with a cleft around them, and we call it strong microinvasive. Again, these are the eosinophilic cells. We've got the cuboidal tumor cells and the eosinophilic cells. These are the microinvasive. Does not adversely affect outcome. And you see approximately 10 to 15%. For some reason, we see it in pregnancy more. And it raised up to ninefold in pregnancy. And there are multiple patterns of this microinvasive. It's just appreciating it. You don't have to call each one what, but looking at the multiple variants that it exists. How about the small invasive low-grade serous carcinoma? Whenever the nest gets bigger than 3 millimeters, then I'm talking about something different. It's low-grade serous carcinoma. So yeah, this could be forming. This is way worse. Agree? So the small invasive low-grade serous carcinoma, even when less than 3 millimeters, it can be associated with recurrence, and it is most of the time this microinvasive associated or displayed micropapillary features. So it is very important, and we should not, whenever we use the word micropapillary, should not a microinvasive should not exceed 5 millimeters. 3 to 5 millimeters. And what's the outcome in general in serous borderline tumor? This is what I have. It's either it'll recur, progress to low-grade serous carcinoma, or it'll go through a benign course. And sometimes the recurrence, it'll progress to low-grade serous carcinoma, and the recurrence might go through a lot of morbidity. This patient will go through surgery multiple times and adhesion for the bowels, or whenever it progresses to low-grade serous carcinoma, they go through mortality. So these tumors are indolent, and the patient can live many years. It's way better than the high-grade serous carcinoma, but these are the behavior of this tumor. Moving to the transformation of low-grade serous carcinoma. may occur a decade after the initial presentation of serous borderline tumor, and the disease starts going on a fast tempo suddenly, and it might go to the omentum, bowel erosion, lymph node sites of transformation. And as I said, moderate cytologic ectopia, mitosis less than 10% high power field. This is when I have to call low grade serous carcinoma. The diagram might be borderline tumor, but in the middle, this is invasive carcinoma, low grade. Somoma bodies might be very prominent or sparse. And this is just to show you about the recurrence and the survival. It doesn't matter if it is low-grade start, low-grade serous carcinoma, or progress from serous borderline to low-grade serous carcinoma. So most of the time it's bilateral and it presents in advanced stage and associated with serous borderline tumor, account for 10% of serous carcinoma, and unfortunately, they are chemo-resistant. High-grade serous carcinoma responds to treatment cisplatin better. And believe it or not, even in the high grade associated with BRCA1, they are more sensitive to chemotherapy. It has KRAS mutations, the BRCA1, BRCA2 are rare, and minimal genomic instability. So many variants of low grade serous carcinoma, all invasive, all with moderate cytologic ectopia, somoma bodies, and mitosis less than 10% high power field. There is a lot of studies regarding the point mutations, and even in the literature, having BRAF mutations associated with better outcome. And this in Kaplan-Meier, having BRAF mutations is better than KRAS mutations. Differential diagnosis, here with the punch card, differentiating these cases as we mentioned and as we talked, clear cell carcinoma, I cannot put more images. How about serum mucinous? Having mixed serous and the mucinous, and I'll talk about it in the mucinous borderline tumor. It is bilateral, high stage, and associated with endometriosis, it behaves the same as serous borderline tumor, the conventional one. And the immunohistochemistry, CK7 positive, 20 negative, BRPR positive. An example of it. And for some reason, it attracts neutrophils a lot. And you see this eosinophilic cells with the cilia adjacent to cells similar to the endocervix. It's usually, right? Another example here is the mucinous. It's the same as the endocervix. Okay, another differential diagnosis, low-grade endometriotic carcinoma, okay? So the serous, it is more papillary, the endometrial more villous. I did not appreciate this that much, but the squamous differentiation, it helps you in the endometrioid a lot. Squamous or squamoid features. WT1, it is positive in serous, negative in endometrioid. And sometimes in the endometrioid, you would see uterine endometrioid carcinoma. Endometriosis is rare in the low-grade serous carcinoma, but very common in the endometrioid. Mesothelial hyperplasia or mesothelioma. But the good thing, serous borderline has a spectrum of changes. It's not uniform. And we have immunohistochemistry. But think about peritoneal mesothelioma. And Dr. Malpica from MD Anderson published probably the most elegant study about the differential diagnosis in peritoneal mesothelioma versus borderline tumor, and she published on peritoneal mesothelioma. This is mesothelial hyperplasia, and the distribution of the disease is a clue one. If that serous will go to the omentum, it will go serosal, uterine and everywhere, but in the mesothelioma is completely different. And the other clue is the monotony and the lack of stratification in the mesothelioma versus in the serous. You would see a lot of different in the cytology and the architecture. Again, in immunohistochemistry, we have a panel for mesothelioma. We need three positive for epithelial, two negative for mesothelial differentiation, and Kellerman can be the most helpful one. You do have panel for mesothelioma? It's a panel for us. It comes like five immunohistochemistry. So this is an example for mesothelial hyperplasia. Multilocular peritoneal inclusion cysts. I've seen a few cases, very interesting. They look like they balloons in the omentum. Very interesting. Well differentiated papillary mesothelioma. And diffuse malignant mesothelioma. The immunohistochemistry that is called the most in the serous phenotype CK7 positive, 20 negative. WT1 positive, PAX8 is very helpful, we use it a lot. P16 could be positive or negative, it depends about how high grade is the tumor. And VR positive, VRST2 negative, and GATA3 negative. And I believe this is just to tell you invasive implant versus non-invasive is very important and you have to differentiate. Even if it is desmoplastic, you're just looking at the cells itself. And the microinvasive, the two types, the single cells and the clusters. And the lymph node involvement also the two types, the single cells and the cluster, and you differentiate the outcome out of it. So in conclusion, serous borderline is a heterogeneous disease, and majority are benign, especially the conventional one. And the microcapillary, we pay attention to it because it progresses to low-grade serous carcinoma, and so many centers, they start calling it serous carcinoma non-invasive, which is, for me, very confusing, so I don't use that word. Invasive implant, you call it invasive low-grade serous carcinoma. And with this, I'll finish this talk. Thank you. Any question?
Yes, please.
Okay, should we take the floor or you first, whatever you want. All right, go ahead. Any questions? Go ahead.
Yes, please.
That's a wonderful question. It is very difficult, but if you read a lot and look at a lot of cases, non-invasive implant, it's the most important criteria for invasive implant that it invades the underneath tissue, it destroys. Remember about cancer, how it invades and it goes through, okay? This is the invasive implant. The non-invasive, it just drops off the implant. You can peel it off. This is non-invasive, okay? Even if it is desmoplastic, look at the periphery of the cluster. You can draw a line. Just think about it, you can pick it up and take it out. It's not infiltrated.
You said if the morphology of the non-invasive implant the same as low-grade serous carcinoma?
Yeah, of course. If it is the morphology, the cytology, if it is look invasive carcinoma, I would call it invasive carcinoma, absolutely.
Even if there is no.
Yeah, most of the time it will be together. You will not have a drop. The example I put if you have a focus or a biopsy. Remember, they do a lot of biopsies in the peritoneum, right? I'm sure your surgeon the same as ours. They stage the patient, so they take a lot of biopsy. If you get one of the biopsy of the implant, I mean, any of the biopsy of the peritoneum, you know, they go from A to K, A, B, C, D, I mean, so many of them. If you get one small cluster, and you don't have surrounding tissue, to, you know, evaluate what I'm talking about. But if it looks like malignant, what's called it malignant? No, I won't use the word. I mean, if it is malignant, if it looks low grade, so it's just normal. I'll call it low grade, so it's just normal. Okay. Go ahead.
I don't get how you are reporting new group involvement in borderline serous tumor. If it is less than 1 millimeter, you just report it as
new group involvement, no micrometastasis, and the patient will good understand this. And whatever is the number of new groups involved, if there are more than two, or, and if everyone less than 1 millimeter, it is also involvement, just involvement, no micrometastasis or so.
That is a great question. Again, absolutely. If it is very small clusters, this will not affect the prognosis. And most of the time, these tumors will go to a big center. The GYN oncologists, they do understand the disease very well, and they do understand your language. So I will not call it metastasis. I will call it involvement. And it will not affect the prognosis. It's the same as the non-invasive implant. The patients will do very well.
It
doesn't matter, even with the number or with the multiple cells adjacent, we do not add them up for measurements. It's the same as the breast, we do not add them up, okay? It's just you look at the largest foci.
Thank you.
Sure.
If you have a tissue core biopsy, one nanometer with you, by the video, and you take a tissue core biopsy, how can you differentiate it from
core biopsy of the ovary or of the ovary? It's a very interesting question. Absolutely, and we face it. It's very difficult. Sometimes I just describe what I see, you know? If it is mild tibia and there is no destroying of the stroma adjacent to it. Remember the example I put? Then I would say serous neoplasm C common. I cannot evaluate. I would say I cannot evaluate. I would write that. You know what I mean? It's a lesion. I cannot, you know. This is what I tell. This is what I put in the comment. Serous neoplasm. Neoplasm, it's a big word. It could be benign, it could be malignant, it could be borderline. So I start with serous neoplasm C common. In the comment, due to the paucity of the biopsy, I cannot evaluate the degree of the activity or the invasion differential diagnosis, either borderline or low grade or high grade, if it is too small. I mean, if you can appreciate the activity, you would help them more if you could say this is low grade. But yeah, I fully agree. Sometimes we cannot tell, and I never speculate, because you know, you don't know. But most of the time, remember, these patients would go before surgery. They go through a lot of workup. So if you have like a very, through ultrasound, right? This is the way they present it. Ultrasound, very complex mass with, they tell me, omental cake. The omental is diffusely involved. I mean, this is without even looking at the slide. This is high-grade serous carcinoma, right? But when the omental, they really look for this small foci, and they biopsied and nothing did, probably this represents more either a borderline or low grade. But again, I always send it to their side. They are the surgeon, they are treating this patient, not me, I'm trying to help them. So I would say I cannot tell. Absolutely. Any other questions?
Yes, please.
Yes, yes. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Thank you very much for your comprehensive lecture. And you actually made a sort of a rapid brainstorming for most of ovarian tumors to ask today. But let me ask you a couple of questions. Is there any role for immunos to help us to differentiate once again between invasive and non-invasive implants?
No.
Okay. The other question, is there any role for STIC in the development of low-grade serous carcinoma of the ovary?
No, one more time, I am not.
Is there any role for STIC, serous tubal intraepithelial carcinoma? Is there any role for STIC for the...
For STIC?
Yes.
STIC, okay, yes. Yeah. Yes, it's very interesting. STIC is very interesting lesion, and we do not... Two things, I want to add two comments for this. We do not submit the entire fallopian tube for any tubal ligation. And I know a lot of centers, they start panicking. STIC is serous intraepithelial carcinoma of the fallopian tube. After BRCA1, BRCA2, and the proliferative tubal ovarian, they start taking them out, we start seeing a lot of this. But only for patients with BRCA1, BRCA2, we submit it entirely. And only in this patient, if we see any cytologic atypia, no invasive, we do P53, okay? And P53 will be positive. Remember, P53, BRCA1, it is the pathway for high-grade serous carcinoma. So I'm talking here about borderline and low-grade serous carcinoma. So now there is no overlap. Is there a case report here and there? It might. You might Google tomorrow and say like, huh, I found a case you didn't talk about. Yeah, for sure there'll be, actually I did some midline search and I found a few case reports. Is it real? It could be, I don't know. Or it could be sampling issue, you know?
Yeah.
So, but I believe there is no role up to now, like we are learning a lot about this disease and every day. Now there is, I did not want to mention it here because it's too advanced and needs another hour, the molecular classifications of ovarian carcinoma, the same I talked about from TCGA, from the endometrial carcinoma. And luckily, we still are doing wonderful with histology. We are really reflecting what's at the molecular level. The low grade is different from the high grade. We can appreciate the low grade, it's different molecular pathway from the high grade.
Molecular pathway.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr.
Thanks. So, my last talk, I'm doing this time. The mucinous. Here, yes, we do, but branch relay.